नाइन्थ क्वेश्चन, ओके प्लीज लिसन. एनीबडी इन दिस क्लास रिमेंबर्स फ्रॉम द प्रीवियस थिंग दैट वी लर्नड अर्लियर, व्हाट इज पॉइंट ऑफ इन्फ्लेक्शन? पॉइंट ऑफ इन्फ्लेक्शन, ओके. The basic definition of point of inflection is the point where curvature changes. The point where curvature changes. Let us say a curve is like this. Okay. Please listen. Up to this point, the convex surface is upper side and concave side is lower side. But after this point, convex surface is lower side and concave is upper side, right? Okay. So from convexity up, it changes to convexity down. This is a point where the transition is taking place. That is called point of inflection. Okay. If you want to explain this in a little bit of physics point of view, let us say I have a road in this shape. On the ground, I have a road in this shape. All right. Let us say a bike is going on this road at a good speed. Okay. I'm sure you might have seen bike races. You know, they'll be going at very good speed. Whenever the curve is there, they'll be bending as if almost they're touching the ground, and they have to again raise up, and they have to turn the other side because immediately there's the next turn. Right, you might have seen that. Okay, all right. Now see, okay, if you have seen that kind of bike races, it is very good. You will understand this point. That's why, not that seeing bike race is good. Okay, listen. You know, I think hardly once in a year or twice in a year they conduct that car races or bike races. Rest of the year they have to maintain that such a big ground, they have to construct such a big tar road, whatever. I think it's a very high quality road, right? Not like, okay, what a waste. I feel best is they should grow some grass and leave the cows there. Really? Okay. We are taking all the land from the animals, and the animals are moving on the hot roads without any waste. Quiet. When that bike is going on this, will the bike will be going perfectly straight, or it has to bend? I think out of your physics to provide, have necessary centripetal force to do that circular motion or whatever it is, it has to bend, right? Okay. But when it is moving on this road, it has to bend this side. Okay. Basically, this is like part of a circle which has a center here. This is a part of a circle which has a center here. It has to bend towards the center. So when this person is going, is bending like this. As it is approaching this point, it should become straight, and then it should bend like this, and it will be going like this. The point where it is perfectly straight is point of inflection, where it doesn't have to bend. There is no curvature. Okay. In math point of view, want to talk about it. Tell me, for this curve, f double dash x is negative or positive, based on yesterday's discussion. What is happening to the slope? Here you have very high positive value. Slowly the slope decreased or increased? Decreased. Second is, here slope is vertical and here slope is horizontal, practically zero. So here f double dash x is less than zero because the slope decreased. Whereas here slope is little less value and slowly increasing to high positive value. Here f double dash x is greater than zero. Then tell me, what is here? F double dash x is zero. Okay. So a point of inflection can be defined as the point where f double dash x is zero. But f double dash x is zero is not important. F double dash x sign should change. That is important. Here f double dash x is negative. Here f double dash x is positive. Sometimes here f double dash x may not be defined here. Okay. So for point of inflection, it is not important that f double dash x should be equal to zero. What is important is f double dash x sign should change from plus to minus or minus to plus, so that the curvature changes, and that's why it is called point of inflection. But many curves, f double dash x will be zero and its sign changes. Okay. But another example, which is a subset of that, but the definition is this only, is let us talk about only f dash x. Let us say for a curve, I found f dash x and the sign change for that. This is 2, 3, 5, 7, 9. It is positive here, negative here, negative here, positive here. And let us say positive here and negative here. Something like this. If this is the sign change for f dash x, tell me at 2, what will happen? The function attains what? Local minimum, because the derivative sign changes from minus to plus. And at 9, what it is? Minimum only, derivative. At 3, what it is? No. It is no maximum, no minimum. That is point of inflection. 3 is point of inflection. Why? The function is increasing, flat, and again increasing. Okay? So, if I really find f double dash x, it will come 0. Later on. But you don't need. Wherever derivative sign is, wherever derivative is 0, wherever derivative is 0, and its sign changes from plus to minus, local maximum. Minus to plus, local minimum. Derivative is 0, but its sign is changing from plus to plus only. Point of inflection. It's changing from minus to minus only. Point of inflection. So, 3 is a point of inflection. And 7 is also a point of inflection. Okay. Here it will be like this. At 7, the graph will be like this. At this point, it is flat. Derivative is 0. But here also function decreasing. Here also function decreasing. It is neither maximum nor minimum. So don't think wherever derivative is 0, it has to be maximum or minimum. Need not be. Okay. If I draw the graph. Okay. Here derivative is 0, local maximum. Here derivative is 0, local minimum. Here also derivative is 0, but it is point of inflection. This is not graph of f dash, this is a graph of f. This is a graph of f. This is a local maximum, this is a local minimum. Derivative is 0 here, 0 here, derivative is 0. Here and here also derivative is 0, but they are not maximum, not minimum, because some values are higher than that, some values are lower than that. How can it be maximum? But still derivative is 0 there, because the tangent is flat there. Okay. If something is touching a line and then going up, definitely here derivative is 0. But it is point of inflection. All right? Okay. Why am I explaining all that? Because this question, we have to discuss about point of inflection here. Few mains questions, I feel they are very good advanced level questions, some of them. All right? Okay, 9th one. When I find f dash x, derivative of sine 2x is cos 2x, and derivative of inner part 2x is 2, and derivative of this cos x is minus sine x. Cos 2x I can write 1 minus 2 sine square x into 2 or minus 2 sine x. That is minus 4 sine square x minus 2 sine x plus 2. If I take minus 2 common, 2 sine square x minus sine x plus 1. Minus 2 into, this is minus 1. Sine x equal to 1 will satisfy. So sine x. Sin x equal to minus 1 will satisfy sin x plus 1 into 2 sin x minus 1. If I take one more 2 common, it is minus 4 into sin x plus 1 into sin x minus 1. X belongs to minus 3 pi by 4 to 3 pi by 4. And f dash x equal to 0 implies, okay. So far things are easy. Simplifying derivative, because this is in terms of sin x, I chose this formula for this cos 2x as 1 minus 2 sin square x. It is a quadratic expression in terms of sin x. Factorize it. We got this. Now tell me, where is the derivative 0 for what values? Whenever sin x is minus 1 or 1 by 2. Sin x equal to minus 1 or 1 by 2. Okay, when is sin x minus 1 between minus 135 degrees to plus 135 degrees? Sure, minus 135 degrees to plus 135, when is sin x minus 1? Minus 135 degrees to 130, minus 90, yes. And when is sin x 1 by 2? Only 30 degrees, nowhere else. Minus pi by 2 or pi by 6. Okay, not just knowing f dash x where it is 0, you have to find f double dash x and see whether it is negative or positive, or you have to look at the sign change. We'll try to do both. Let us look at the sign change first of all. Let me understand sin x graph between 135 degrees to minus 135. Okay, actually sin x graph is like this between minus pi to pi, but I'm only drawing between minus 135 to 135. Sin x will be 1 by 2 only at 30 degrees. And minus 1 at minus 90 degrees. That's all. Okay. Now let us see what will happen to the sign of this. This is, I am taking sin x values. If sin x is 1 by 2, derivative is 0. When sin x is minus 1, derivative is 0. And when sin x maximum value is 1, I cannot go beyond 1 or before minus 1. Whenever sin x is more than 1 by 2, this is positive. But this is always positive. When sin x is between minus 1 to 1, sin x plus 1 is between what to what? When sin x is between minus 1 to 1, sin x plus 1 is between what to what? 0 to 2. When it is minus 1, 0. When it is plus 1, 2. If it is 0 to 2, is it always positive? Yes. This is always positive. So everything depends on this. So when sin x is more than 1 by 2, this is positive, but with a minus, it will be negative. And when sin x is less than 1 by 2, this is negative with a minus, it will be positive. Okay. This is not playing any role because it is always between 0 to 2, which is practically positive. Now, these are only sin x values. What if I take x values? I will take 30 degrees or pi by 6. Here, minus 3 pi by 4. Here, 3 pi by 4. And there is a minus pi by 2 here. Okay. You have to mainly understand here, when x is more than 30 degrees, sin x values are more than 1 by 2. All these are more than 1 by 2. And during that time, our f dash is negative. When x value is more than 30, sin x is more than 1 by 2, and already we know sin x. When x is before 30, sin x is less than 1 by 2, and during that time, our derivative is positive everywhere, here also, here also. But at minus 90, derivative is 0. Except at that point, everywhere else positive. Okay, this positive came here, this negative came here for x values. Now tell me, at pi by 6, is the derivative 0? Yes. Is the sign changing from plus to minus? So what it is? Local maximum. Right? Okay. Whereas at minus pi by 2, what is happening? Derivative is 0, because this is 0. This is mostly positive, but at one point it is 0. But before and after, the derivative is positive. Then what is that? Point of inflection. It's neither maximum nor minimum. So this is POI I am writing. Point of inflection. Okay, that is the answer, by the way. Okay, let us see what would have come if I found f double dash x. F double dash x, when I differentiate this, minus 8 sin x cos x minus 2 cos x. What is f dash 30 degrees? Pi by 6. I can even take here minus 2 cos x common. I'll get 4 sin x plus 1. F dash pi by 6 is definitely negative. That much I can see. Whereas f dash minus pi by 2, if I take, what will come? It is 0. F double dash. Okay. Please listen. The point where first derivative is 0, but second derivative is negative. Local maximum. Okay. The point where first derivative is 0, but second derivative is positive. Local minimum, but we did not get that. The point where first derivative is 0 and even second derivative is 0. It may be maximum or minimum, you have to go for third derivative actually. But if you know the sign change of this, at minus pi by 2 it is 0. But after minus pi by 2 it has one sign, before minus pi by 2 it has another sign. Because there is a sign change in the second derivative, it is point of inflection. If you want that, if I take anything more than minus 5, let's say minus 60 degrees or something, okay, this is definitely negative. At minus 90, it is negative, so it is negative. This is positive. This is negative. This is positive. When so it is positive here, if I find properly, this will come negative because of this. Because f double dash sign changed at minus pi by 2, it is a point of inflection. This is a better method, but you want to understand like this also, nothing wrong. F double dash sign changes, you have to understand. Those are online. I hope everything is clear to you. One of you can respond.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Critical point and inversion point. Okay, fine. Critical points are the points where the derivative is zero. It may be local maximum, local minimum, point of inflection. Everything is there in that. The point where derivative is zero. The point where function is not differentiable, the points where function is not continuous, and the beginning of the interval, end of the interval, they are all called critical points.
Okay.
Now, coming to point of inflection, is it compulsory that at point of inflection, first derivative should be zero? No. This kind of point of inflection, first derivative is zero. Look at this. Look at this and rotate this by slightly like this. This is a point of inflection, this is a point of inflection because curvature is changing. But here first derivative is zero, but here first derivative is not zero. Okay, so point of inflection, it is not compulsory that first derivative should be zero. So point of inflection need not be critical points. But some critical point may be point of inflection where the first derivative is zero, but its sign is not changing from plus to minus or minus to plus. It is remaining plus only or remaining minus only. They are also called point of inflection, but they are not covering all points of inflection. They are some of the points of inflection. Okay. So critical points are something. Point of inflection are something. They have an intersection. There are some points which are both critical points and point of inflection. But there are many other critical points which are not point of inflection. There are also many other points of inflection which are not critical points also.
Okay, everybody completed? Okay, this is what is the number 9, right? Okay, 12th I am not going to discuss. Read 12th question and see, tell me whether you have seen similar question anytime before. Yesterday question number 51 in part 1, everything is same. Instead of f of x equal to f of 0, f of 9x equal to f of 0. All right. So we are going to do next 15. Okay. In 15th question, they gave a function. They said x equal to 1 is a critical point. That means derivative is 0 there. So let us find f dash x. They also gave f dash 1 equal to 0 basically. When I differentiate, I'll get 3x square plus ax minus 2 minus a into e power x plus e power x into derivative of this is 6x plus a. When I take e power x common, I'll get 3x square plus a plus 6 into x, a will cancel minus 2. I can find a value because they gave f dash 1 equal to 0. F dash 1 equal to 0 means e power 1 into 3 plus a plus 6 minus 2 equal to 0. You get a equal to minus 7. Put that minus 7 back, you can find the function. F dash x is e power x equal 3x square minus x minus 2. E power x, this can be factorized as x minus 1 into 3x plus 2. If I take 3 common, 3 e power x into x minus 1 into x minus minus 2 by 3. Actually, without finding a value, directly from this I can write this. How? I don't need to find a value. I know for this equation 1 is a root. It's a quadratic equation, 1 is a root. I want to find other root. What is the product of the roots here? Minus 2 by 3. C by A, minus 2 by 3. And already I know alpha is 1. If one root is 1 and product of roots is minus 2 by 3, other root should be minus 2 by 3. A quadratic equation with roots 1 and minus 2 by 3 is this. With some for leading coefficient is 3 e power x. That's it. I don't have to waste time finding a value. I can directly tell this or find a first and then substitute back and then factorize. Doesn't matter. Now take the number line. Minus 2 by 3 and 1. After 1, it is positive here, negative here, positive here. Because the derivative sign changes from plus to minus, it is local maximum. And this is local minimum because derivative sign changes from minus to plus. Wherever derivative is 0 and its sign changes from plus to minus, local maximum. Wherever derivative is 0, sign changes from minus to plus, local minimum. That is options are those two only. This is a very easy question, not at all difficult. Those you completed, try 18th question. Thank you. Okay, completed. Okay, done. Okay, they gave a function which is continuous and differentiable, and even the derivative differentiable again, once again, twice differentiable. And they gave this data. Based on that, they're asking f double dash x, should it be 0 one time or always or something like that. Okay. Now, I can explain this graphically, but let me do first of all by using Rolle's theorem. F of 0 equal to f of 1, from this I can say by Rolle's theorem, there exists some alpha which belongs to 0 to 1 such that f dash alpha is equal to 0. Correct now? Rolle's theorem says whenever f of a equal to f of b, between a to b the function is continuous and differentiable, there exists a point between them such that the derivative is 0. Okay. Now, look at this and look at this. F dash 0 is 0, f dash alpha is 0. I can write f dash 0 equal to f dash alpha. Both are equal to 0. That equal to 0 is not important here. For Rolle's theorem, these two should be equal. They're equal to 7 or 100 or 0, doesn't matter. These two are equal. So I can say now by Rolle's theorem, there exists some point between 0 to beta. I'm applying Rolle's theorem for f dash. F dash a equal to f dash b means between a and b, f double dash x will have one solution. Okay. So there exists beta belongs to 0 to 1 or some c belongs to 0 to 1 such that 0 to alpha, yes. And which is a subset of 0 to 1. It is 0 to alpha, but that is a part of 0 to 1. Such that f dash c is 0. Okay. F double dash, yes. The derivative of f dash, yeah. So finally, what we got? There will be at least one point where second derivative is 0. And where is that point? Between 0 to alpha. So between 0 to alpha, it is also between 0 to 1. So I can say now there exists x such that there exists x belongs to 0 to 1 such that f double dash x equal to 0. So it is not necessary that everywhere f double dash x should be 0. It is not that it should happen at 0, something in between. If you want to explain graphically, see, at 0 the function is 0. At 1 also the function is 0. But there is a difference. That one, it is crossing x-axis, means the derivative is not zero. But at zero, it is touching x-axis. That means derivative is zero. Now we can see there is one more point also where derivative is zero. That only we are calling alpha, which is between 0 to 1. Now, f dash 0 is 0, f dash alpha is 0. Between them, we apply Rolle's theorem. We'll find there is a point where second derivative is 0, which I can easily identify it is this point, that is C. You know why? You can see after this, the curve is like this. F double dash x is actually convex up. And for this one, convex down. Is this a point of inflection? At that point, second derivative is 0. So there exists a point where second derivative is 0. It is between 0 to alpha. It is also between 0 to 1. Doesn't mean everywhere derivative should be 0. Doesn't mean here second derivative should be 0. So that's why the option B is correct. F double dash x equal to 0 for some x between 0 to 1. Okay. These are somewhat like advanced questions only. Okay, not direct application of Rolle's theorem, little more involved. Okay, I want everybody to complete maximum minimum rest of the questions, both part 1 and part 2 by tomorrow, if any gaps are there. Okay, we'll discuss all doubts tomorrow. Today I'll just continue with straight lines, 2D geometry now.
Figure you can find very easy. Join this. You don't need that option. This has some radius, right? Join to this, this, this. Okay. First of all, you have to find this radius itself. The radius of these three you have to find. Oh, that is given. Okay, then it's very easy. You know this length, you know this length, this length. No? Okay. You can find the circumradius of that new equilateral triangle. If this is 2r, 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 what is the circumradius of that? 2r by capital R equal to a by 2 sine 60. You get some value. From that, subtract smaller, you get that. No, there is some area here, some area here. Area is a problem. But why? You want the radius of this circle, na? Area of what? The circle. Oh, there is no circle, only that region. Oh, then it's very easy, na? Remove the three circles, right? I thought you were asking that circle. You have done one more circle. Okay, quiet. All of you, please listen. If you look at in pair of straight lines, the last
7 questions, 91 to 97. They are based on pair of straight lines, which many years back, around 2006 or 7, they used to be in syllabus. Now pair of straight lines is not there. They may give, but in they are not giving nowadays. It is not there officially in the syllabus. Both for JEE Mains and Advanced, pair of straight lines is not there. But sometimes a simple application may come in Advanced, but not in Mains. Chances are very less. So you can at least try to do up to 90. And even numbers as far as possible. Some odd numbers I want to discuss. Or let me discuss 2020. It will be easy for me. Okay. Not 27. 17 questions. Yes. Quiet. Okay. Take 2D geometry part 2. Page number 27 in part 2. Page number 27, part 2. There are 17 questions. I want to do all of them in today's and tomorrow's class as far as possible. Today, is it 115 to 215 in maths counseling today? Okay. Listen. I have again class 115 to 215. During that time also, I will teach only. We will try to finish 2D geometry today. So that if you have tomorrow, we will discuss all doubts. Okay. Anything you have, either any one of us. Okay, very first question in 2D geometry. A ray of light is projected from the origin at an angle of 60 degrees with the positive direction of x-axis towards the line y equal to 2. Okay. So y equal to 2 is a line like this. From origin at an angle 60, you have drawn a line like this. This angle is 60. It is hitting here. This is y equal to 2. Okay. Gets reflected at the point alpha comma 2. The distance of the reflected ray of light from the point 2 comma 2. Okay. 2 comma 2 is somewhere here. They are asking this perpendicular distance. Okay. The reflected ray, what are the perpendicular distance from 2 comma 2 to that? That's the question. Okay. You know, angle of incidence equal to angle of reflection. This is 60, this is 30, this is 60. In fact, parallel lines alternate interior angles. This is also 60. Okay, right? Okay. And what about this length? What is this height is 2, right? What is this length will be 2? If I take tan 30, will it come this by this? Yeah. So this should be 2 by root 3. Am I right? Is it 2 by root 3? Okay. Now, if this is 2 by root 3 and total is 2, what is this length? Two minus 2 by root 3. Okay. What the answer says some kind of, yeah. So I'm trying to do everything from that. So this is alpha comma 2 is actually this length is 2 minus 2 by root 3. I think from triangle only I can find this distance. Where I know this, I want to find this, okay, or h or something. What I should take opposite side and hypotenuse, I should take sine 60. So sine 60 in this figure, from this figure, opposite side is h, and this is 2 minus 2 by root 3. So h will be root 3 by 2 into 2 minus 2 by root 3. When you multiply, you are getting root 3 minus 1. This is one method, method one. Method two, if you don't want to worry about all this, you can try to find this line equation itself. And then from point to a line, you can apply perpendicular distance formula. Okay. If you want to know this line, you should know two points or one point and slope. Slope is easy because if this is 60, this is 60, this is 60, this is 120. So the slope of the reflected ray is tan 120. M is equal to tan 120, which is minus root. You should know one point. You can find this point or this point, whichever you want. Okay. If somebody wants to take this point, this is 2 by root 3. 2 comma 2 is a little off. It's not here. 2 comma 2 is somewhere here, but it's okay. This is 2 by root 3 because this is 2. This is 4 by root 3 comma 0. So that is y minus 0. Equal to minus root 3 into x minus 4 by root 3. That is y equal to minus root 3x plus 4. Okay, root 3x plus y minus 4 equal to 0. Now, from 2 comma 2, when you find distance formula, mod root 3 into 2 plus 2 minus 4 by root over 3 plus 1. From a point x1, y1 to a line ax plus by plus c equal to 0, the perpendicular distance is mod ax1 plus by1 plus c by root a square plus b square. When you do that, down is 2. This is 2 root 3 minus 2. Cancel 2. You got root 3 minus 1.
Yeah.
Somebody can find the line and apply perpendicular distance formula, or directly from the this small triangle, you know this length, you know this angle, you can find this. Can draw some proper figure if somebody wants. Once again,
Thank you.
Okay, clear everybody? First one. Quiet. Some people are deaf here. Okay, second question, they gave three vertices A, 1 comma 0, B, 6 comma 2 something. B is a point inside the triangle such that they have equal areas. Okay, it's very easy. Listen. In the second question, they want a point inside the triangle. This is A, this is B, this is C. There is a point P such a way that when you join to the three vertices, this area, this area, this area should be equal. Do you know any such point? Centroid. Okay. Each area will be one third of the total because this height is one third of this. Quiet. This is a very simple point of question, looks very big, but when you understand, what is that point which is making the three triangles of equal area is P should be centroid. Okay, so only you have to know centroid formula, which is sum of the x coordinates by 3, sum of the y coordinates by 3. So when you add, you are getting 7 plus 3 by 2, 1 plus 6 plus 3 by 2 by 3, 0 plus 2 plus 6 by 17 by 6 and 8 by 3. Now we have to find distance from here. What is that to talk so much? Keep on, you are talking only. And whenever I say like this, those are talking, they look as if, you know, about whom I'm talking. They pretend like that. Okay. Okay. You have to understand centroid. That's the main point. After that, they just want PQ distance. P is centroid. Q is already given as minus 7 by 6 comma minus 1 by 10. So 17 by 6 plus 7 by 6 whole square, 8 by 3 plus 1 by 3 whole square. 18 by 6, 3, 3 square is 9, and 9 by 3 is also 3, that is also 9, which is 3 root 2. Oh, this is a numerical question, so you have to round it off. They give 5, did I write something wrong? 24 by 6 is 4, sorry. Okay. 4 square plus 3 square, which is 5. Exactly 5, 5.00. Usually in maths, you don't have any confusion about numerical values and rounding off and all. Mostly they're giving integers or the fractions which will cut somewhere only. Okay. I think in physics and especially in chemistry, you may have some confusion here and there. Okay. They are giving NTA questions written to you, right? That key is also given, na? So those questions, you, when you solve, you will know where you can go wrong or how to write numerical values. Okay. Are they giving some decimals and all in chemistry? No, they are also numericals only, most simple integers. Is there any clarity on JEE Main syllabus? Earlier they said full syllabus, and in between, one day back or 2 days back, educational ministers he said it is only on the reduced portion.
And again, after that, somebody said there was a correction from NTA again and saying the full syllabus, something like that. So best is prepare for full syllabus. Let them be whatever. Okay, thank you. We'll meet in the afternoon again.